past illness.
Now we're listening to his grandson.
Almost his most famous poem, Crossing the Bar. He was preoccupied with death from early childhood. Sir Charles Tennyson, his grandson and biographer, remembers him in the days after his last illness and after he had written Crossing the Bar, and he remembers him vividly.
I suppose I'm the last person alive who has any at all intimate recollections of Tennyson. Of course, it's nearly 77 years since he died. At the age of 83, he was just 83, and I was approaching the end of my 13th year, so that I was quite old enough to have a fairly strong impression of him. And there were circumstances which rather threw us together. Of course, I was his grandson, and then my father died at the age of just over 31, when I was 6, and that perhaps intensified the interest which my grandparents took in my brothers and myself, so that I had many opportunities of seeing him. Of course, 77 years is a very long time. Nevertheless, my memories of him are extraordinarily vivid, because he was the most extraordinary personality in a very long life. He's by far the most impressive and singular personality that I've ever come across. He was very tall, well over 6 feet high, very broad, very powerfully made. He had very large hands with curiously square fingertips. Somebody once said that they looked to be fit for kneading clay or dough, and I think that was a very good description. Then he had a very tall head, which rose to an egghead type of crown, rather bald, and then fringed by a rather untidy sort of fringe of very dark hair. His hair never changed colour hardly at all. And he had, as everyone knows, in his old age, rather a long, grizzled beard. He was very dark and swarthy, much, much more like a Spaniard than an Englishman. He had very, very dark eyes with rather heavy lids, and he was terribly short-sighted. He was very aquiline in features. And one thing which added greatly to the impressiveness and the singularity of his appearance was the clothes which he always wore. Now, he always, until the end of his life, wore the same style of clothes. I very nearly said the same clothes, which might not have been far from the truth. That he had worn in the reign of King William IV, when he was a young man with his brothers and his university friends, and he always wore the same type of clothes as he'd worn then, which I remember particularly, a long sleeveless sort of Spanish cloak with a velvet collar, dark blue or black, and a large black wide-awake hat with very broad brim, felt hat, and then he nearly always wore a sort of John Bull frock coat, halfway between a tail coat and a frock coat, with very big poacher's pockets at the sides, and rather baggy trousers, which, as he went a little bit over at the knees in old age, it made his legs look rather like the hind legs of an elephant. He was a tremendous walker. He walked every morning and many afternoons as well, and he observed ceaselessly as he walked. And he also composed, I feel sure, a great deal at that time. He had a rather curious gait as a walker. It was a sort of gliding or shuffling step, rather. An eminent American poet who saw him in London in the 50s, I think, said it reminded him rather of a Red Indian. It was rather furtive, and at the same time, they decided, although he always breakfasted alone, normally he liked to have his meals with company, and he was very fond of his food. That was rather an unexpected trait, perhaps. One very characteristic incident I remember connected with lunch at Aldworth, I may call it the incident of the fungi. And he'd been out walking one morning, and he came back with the great wide-awake hat full of the most terrible-looking fungi, which he brought into the drawing-room where I happened to be with my grandmother, and he showed her this hat full of these terrible objects, And he said, Emily, will you please have these cooked for lunch?
As you can hear, this is quite interesting. Gives you a good idea about Tennyson. And we will continue next with The Lady of Shalott.